morning to everybody out there in TV land. This is Mike Hittner with Historic Point Boss Update. And joining me today on my right is Tom Bramer. Welcome, Tom.
Good morning. Good morning.
And we're going to have, I don't know if it's a treat for you or a treat for both of us, but we're going to kind of go back through history, talk about a little bit of the forming of the organization, and we're going to go through talking about each of the buildings, where they came from, how they got there, what happened in the process, and should be kind of informative for some of you maybe that are, know about us but don't know the background of the buildings and the organization. It should be shed some light on some of that sort of thing. So we'll start with the organization. Probably the main person in, was responsible for it was Dave Engel by writing of his articles in the newspaper. He had written a bunch of articles over probably about a two-year span about this old homestead in the town of Saratoga, the Wakely homestead, and promoting it and everything. And in fact, Dave has mentioned me a number of times of all the things he's written about over the years about old buildings and historic things in the community. This is, I think, the only thing that's really been saved to any extent anyway. So it started in probably about 1984. In 1985, a group of people got together. Central to that was the Central Wisconsin Home Builders Association. They were the forerunners of everything that we do today. They got together, especially the Dave and Judy Teske and a number of other individuals, Brian McDermott, a number of those people, and in the home builders kind of took it by hand and kind of brought it forward. I joined the organization in probably about August of 85. There was a little joke out there that my wife asked me how many you know nights or whatever a month this was going to be, and I said two or three, and the only joke was if we were home two or three nights of the month. It was the opposite of what we had kind of said, sort of thing. So in August of 85, they had a meeting I went to. It's kind of an organizational meeting, and then the board of directors got elected, and in January, Art Bernhardt, was a VP at the Nacoosa Papers, handed the keys over to us. That was a formal thing in the January of 1986. So we got the keys handed to us. And what we originally intended to do was to save the building and that sort of thing. We had almost 1,000 members at one time, now probably in the 100, maybe a little over 100 at this time. But what we had to do is we had to hire an architectural historian to kind of find out what was original, what was changed. This house is 140 some years old, so there's going to be a lot of changes happening in this house. And so,
you know, about the 1,000 people, the first year they had raffle. Mm-hmm. And you got a membership
with
and raffle ticket.
Yes.
So everybody that bought a membership or bought a raffle ticket was a member.
Oh, that was
for that first year. That's how I got in.
That's kind of a sneaky way. Huh?
Yeah. And so then you were a member for one whole year, and then
they'd send you a renewal notice.
Well, in the course of the last 30 years, we've lost, you know, people have died off or moved away.
Sure.
But that's how the first great big group got together.
Yeah. Yeah. And I know they always wanted to hit 1,000, but I think as I remember, it was like 940 or 950 was as high as it ever got in those first two, 3 years. And then we kind of lost a few members because we took this slow approach. Find out what's original. So, you know, Stuart McDonald from McDonald and Associates came down from Minneapolis and he studied everything. And looking at plaster marks on lath, what was original? We knew the stairway going up to the second floor wasn't original in the house that we got from Nacoosa Papers, because it was on the south side covering a window. They never would have done that. It was on the exterior wall. And now, of course, it's in the middle of the house, and that's more appropriate, I feel. And I think from what we found, it's probably the way it was.
Yeah.
And the stairwell would always, from the front of the house faces the river, would have always went up from that point, not from the back of the house, the back door, as we approach it by road or walking nowadays. So. We lost a membership because some people, nothing against the Central Wisconsin Home Builders, but some of those people like to do things and get things done. And of course, we weren't just going to do things just to get things done. We, at least the board of directors, decided to take the slow approach. So that's a little bit of a of a piecemeal look at why things happen and why it took the house was jacked up for probably 3 years, Tom.
Oh yeah.
It was jacked up. We had the what do they call it? Wisconsin Conservation Corps.
Yep, WCC.
And they, that was, it's non-existent anymore. But they were young people that needed a trade or a job, and they went there and got some training, and they had a leader, and they helped us with a lot of rebuilding the walls of the basement, mm-hmm. and jacking up, getting the floor straight, because originally the house, when we got it, had two French doors on the riverside. Well, Wakely's day, they didn't have those, those sort of things. So, and the floor was buckled like a S curve, if you could see a picture mm-hmm. of it.
I fell through it once.
So, anyway, that process took longer, I guess, than any of us thought at the time, but it was well worth it, I think, when we look at the final product now. So, we don't know exactly when the house was built, but we figure about 1841. They probably came, they did come on June 2nd, 1837, but didn't have time to build a house like this, nor maybe the materials were present at the time, because they were just starting to cut the white pine in northern Wisconsin just about the time the Wakeleys were coming. So this was all right on the edge of that. Probably lived in something like the lean-to for the first 3, 4, 5 months, then built the log cabin such as the trader's cabin that Tom is.
Or lived in one that was already there, who knows?
Right.
But they didn't build the house right away, that's for sure.
And so it took a little while before then, and then a lot of the reports of Robert Wakely, he was up the river and down the river. He's helping Daniel Whitney do this. He's helping George Stevens do that. So he was up and down and gone. You got to give a lot of credit to Mary Wakely, one of the probably unsung heroes in this whole Robert Mary Wakely scenario, and that she probably, with a couple of the older boys, probably ran the whole thing for months at a time, maybe, because he was gone so much helping out and entrepreneuring and trying to do this job and that job. So. The house was originally red. Of course, that wasn't the original color, white. Probably, Tom, looking back, one mistake we probably made was probably on the windows.
Mm-hmm.
It should be what over?
6/9 light. So it'd be 9 windows on the top and 6 panes on the bottom, little ones.
Yeah. The architectural historian had come up that he thought these were original windows, but I think it was too big of pieces of panes of glass to get here in one piece.
He said the windows were original, but what he didn't say to us, or we didn't hear, depending on
what we wanted here,
what the sashes were in the windows. Mm-hmm. So the windows, the window frames and that were original, and they still are, but the sash that goes up and down, that had been changed sometime in that 140 years. Mm-hmm. And we didn't, either didn't hear it or didn't understand it. So we went and made the 2/2 light windows that are in there now.
Right.
And that's not correct. But unless somebody wants to give us a few thousand dollars to replace them, they're going to have to live with them for a while.
It was very expensive. We had those custom made, those windows, and out of nice white pine and everything. And that, and we've got the kind of the foggy, or not the foggy, but the ripply glass in there.
As much as we could.
So it kind of looks the old fashioned, but it probably should have been 6/9, and that probably would have been more appropriate to that era of the house built sort of thing. So let's go on to the Columbia School. The Columbia School was on property owned by John Dove Jr., and he was behind Kmart. Kmart today is Rapids Ford. Kmart used to be there. He was going to build a new workshop, a pole shed of some sort, and the town, that wasn't in the city at the time, the town said that you could only have so much square footage in buildings or something, so he offered it to us. He called me up and a couple others. We went to look at it. It was used as a workshop. There was a little bit of wainscoting in there and stuff, but it doesn't look like it does today. Pretty tough shape. And then we got some movers to move it, but we dropped the roof, because if we had the roof on it and moved it, we would end up, you know, paying for all these wires to be lifted or taken down or something, and it would have cost us thousands more than what it did cost us. So it was moved from that site behind Rapids Ford to the site. Now, originally it stood at the corner of 13 and
Church
Street, where the lawn ornament place is on the south east corner there, and it was used originally, as I a one-room school for all 8 grades in the town of Saratoga. But as they got more people in the town, then it was used as 4 grades, and then other schools took, you know, other grades.
The old town hall, it's still standing out there, was the other four.
The other four.
Was the Columbia School and the town hall school.
Mm-hmm. So we moved it to the site. The original plan was to use it as an interpretive center. So we put it up on the hill where it sits today, up on the top parking lot. It sits on a full basement. When we originally put it in, it had just a basement. It's about 16 by 32 or something, the school itself. And we built a basement underneath it just because we thought, well, for storage and different things we'd have. And it was good and sandy, wasn't ever going to get wet there. So we put that basement under it. And then about 5 years later, through the auspices of the Cranberry people, the Walkers, and Rob Nury, they came in with some of their workers. I think we provided materials, but they provided the workmanship and everything. And we added on the modern bathrooms. And then, of course, below that is a kitchen and a locker room and that sort of thing underneath that. So that was put on about 5 years after the original. But that was quite a project, the Columbia School, Tom. You remember that, trying to get that thing square? Since we took
it's
the roof down,
impossible.
We could never get the thing square after that point.
And there was, at one time, we had the rafters back up. Mm-hmm. And we just had plastic sheeting over the top, and it was like, I want to say it was deer season, and it was raining and snowing, and that was all coming in. Mm-hmm. And I happened to be president then, and I had a guy offer me, a fella I know that does carpentry work. He says, I can have a roof on that thing in 3 days for X amount of dollars. So I did the phone poll of the board of directors, and the minute I got the fifth guy to say yes, put her on.
Yeah.
And but they did put the roof on. That actually kind of, I think, saved the building.
Right.
And then Walkers and them did the, when they put on the addition, they put a new floor system in. Mm-hmm. The old one,
was all
that was log
logs.
Sleepers in there.
Yeah.
That's now underneath the log cabin. Mm-hmm. That is down by the river.
Sure.
But we took them out and they put a new floor system in. Well, that squared it up. Mm-hmm. And then after that, it was awful lot of work. Wainscoting, there's at least 3 different patterns.
3 different wainscoting, different widths of it in that school.
From different
because
schools.
As it had been used as a workshop, some of that had disappeared over the years. The chalkboards came from the old Nakusa
Alexander School.
Because Dick Millenbaugh was on our board of directors at the time, and I think he was head of the district in Nakusa. And he said, well, go over to the old Alexander School. This was before it had been sold for whatever purposes they use it for now. But he said, go over and take what you like out of there. So we got some chalkboards out of there. Mm-hmm. And the wainscoting, Tom and I put the floor in. That's a act of a real
trust.
Trust. When you got this guy slinging this hammer at this this nailer.
Yeah, it's supposed to be done one guy, hold the nailer and swing the hammer. But because we were reusing 100-year-old oak flooring, or maple flooring,
maple, yeah.
It was so hard you couldn't set the nail with one guy. So one guy would hold the driver, or the
nailer.
The nailer, and the other guy take a full roundhouse swing to hit that. And he's about that far from the other guy's hand when he hits it. And it's like, and we did that for months.
Yeah.
And there's an awful lot of flooring in that place.
Yeah, yeah.
That was crazy.
And then Terry, remember the
Burkholz.
Last? Burkholz refinished the floor. So
yeah.
That was nice because it had been, you know, walked on and scratched and we had tearing it out. And so a lot of that flooring had been kind of worn out sort of things. Terry
sanded it
down and put a couple coats of
he was building chairman for several years, and
yeah,
by gum,
Terry did a nice
I mean
job.
He'd grab a hold of the bull by the horns and went.
Yeah.
And then the ceiling.
Yes.
There was tin ceiling in there to start with, but nowhere near enough of it that we could fill it in. So we went and bought reproduction tin ceiling.
Yeah, it's made from the same company, the same pattern.
Mm-hmm.
We could trace it. There's a company in St. Louis that makes this tin, pressed tin ceiling. and we could track it. And in fact, when we were looking for some in the basement the other day, I saw on the top of a shelf of, in the basement of the schoolhouse, there's a couple more of those sheets, because
really?
you always buy a couple extra sheets of it. And it's, I think it was 2x3 sheets or something like that. And they go little dome nails, little round dome nails to put it up. And that was a project, putting it up and also get it in so it looked good. You know?
Yeah, the building, while they did square it up, it's not perfect. I mean, the building was over 100 years old when we got it, 130 years old when we got it. So the upper part, and you're trying to hit holes punched in tin with two layers, and it doesn't fit the wall. We finally got it.
Yeah.
But my goodness, I mean, some of those pieces were up and down several times.
Yeah.
That was not a fun project.
And originally, like I had mentioned to begin with, it was supposed to be an interpretive center, but one of our early members and school teacher, and one-room school teacher by trade, was Gene Fritz. Mm-hmm. And Gene kind of, before we knew it, had kind of decided, let's have a school in here. And it turned out great, of course, but there went our interpretive center. But we were originally going to have his two or three desks up front and a little look of a school,
yeah,
but use it as an interpretive center. Now we're looking at maybe in the next 2 or 3 years to actually build an interpretive center that would be dedicated,
yeah,
to that purpose sort of thing. So, but that's kind of the story of the Columbia School. A long project, very nice, very good reuse of a building.
Mm-hmm.
Normally, I think if John Dubb didn't get somebody to take it, he would have probably tore it down just because he needed to have less square footage when he put up his new building. So thanks to John and to a lot of members and a lot of effort by a lot of people and the walkers and the addition on there and squaring things out a little bit, it looks great now. It's
mm-hmm.
kind of one of the first things you see when you come to the site, you go up the hill. And that's interpreted about 1925. We do that because it has electric lights in it. It was used for a school for 100, 101 years, but we interpret it as about 1925. Now, when we cross the creek, we're crossing on the bridge that Al Giese and his family put together, and kind of a project that they did. It was kind of engineered by
Lampert Lee
and associates out there. And it's made, the bridge that you go across is made so the water, if it gets high, goes around it so it doesn't wash the bridge out. I think that's the way they engineered it sort of thing. And it's held up through all that sort of thing. But Al Giese, Jim Giese, the whole family, they're kind of participating. That was kind of their project for building that bridge. And then we go up the hill there, and then on our left, we got the three-bay shed. Now this is almost an exact copy of the three-bay shed that's on the Oliver Kelly farm in Minnesota. Oliver Kelly was the originator of the Grange movement. That was kind of a rural farm grouping and sort of thing, and I think it even exists today.
It does.
And we had been up there, a number of us, for a MOMSI conference, a Midwest historic conference, and there was a nice three-bay shed there. And so we decided, well, we need a shed to, originally just more to store things in, but now of course it's ice house is one bay, and then they have a carpenter shop in the middle, and then they got a sawyer shop on the south side. So it's kind of divided into three, though they're all interchangeable in that. But that was a nice project also, because that most of the lumber out of that, folks, you can tell how scroungy we are. Consolidated Papers was building their new
Number 16
unit, and they had all these boxes, rough cut lumber, that you can see on some of the boxes, or even inside of the three bay shed. It's got Voigt Company, sending it to Consolidated Papers. We went out to their boneyard and salvage it. They were going to burn it or do something with it, and they gave us, I think we went there 2 weekends and we got as much materials, and then basically other than the beams and everything there, I think it built most of that three-bay shed. So,
and I think the original beams for that, if I'm not mistaken, came from Walker Cranberry also.
Right.
They tore down one of their old sorting sheds that had been there since, time immemorial.
Sure.
And we were able to use those. Al Giese and Rob Nury were the two that really worked on that shed. And we just saw the Oliver Kelly shed again 2 years ago,
yes,
a year and a half ago. Ours is a lot nicer than theirs. Now, it's a lot newer, certainly.
Right.
But we're interpreting ours better than they are. Mm-hmm. Now, that's, don't tell the state of Minnesota that,
no,
because
no,
they
no.
run the site, but
right.
but our carpenter shop and our ice house in there, I think we're using the space much more efficiently and more for education than the original one. And mm-hmm. like I say, don't tell them I said so.
Yeah, and that three-bay shed has been a godsend for us, because in the early years we stored a lot of extra wood and stuff in there. In fact, we remember those days before festival, and Rob Nury'd come and he'd sort out all that stuff. He'd drag everything out of that shed and have it all piled up and everything, and then he'd put it back in, and of course we would be working around there. And then, of course, when we got some materials out, we just shove them back in there, and we had no order to it. And Rob would create order to it, and he did this for umpteen festivals. And now, of course, we don't have that problem, because we have a pole building that for storage, and we don't have to worry about that sort of thing. But
if we could have put into honest-to-goodness work the amount of time we did moving material, why? We'd have been done half the time.
Yeah. And just to tell you how high the water can get, when the river gets high, and it's been a little high lately, but it's not high by big standards. The river acts like a dam, and it dams up the Wakely Creek. A number of years ago, that water backed up from the creek and came up all the way and floated stuff in the chicken coop, which we affectionately call the chicken coop, and the three-bay shed. Things were floating in there.
Yep.
And you can see how that high that water has to be, because it has to come up all that creek bed, and that creek bed is pretty low compared to this. Had to come up like 12, 15 feet,
at least.
And then float stuff. And there was enough that it floated things around, moved things around, and we had to clean up, and we had to, you know, take the saws out and take care of them so they didn't rust and things like that. So you can see how high that creek can get historically.
The road bridge that you drive to on Wakely Road, I crossed that in chest waders, and I was worried about getting water in the chest waders.
That's how high
it was. I mean, it was this deep on me standing in the road. And normally it's like 5 feet below the road, so it was horrendous.
And if it would be a little less than that, say that we could drive across, it was 2 or 3 feet deep, you could see the fish going across.
Yep.
And then you'd have to kind of walk across the bridge first just to make sure there's a bridge underneath it. Otherwise, it might not be there, and then you might find out yourself floating down the creek. So Tom is honest with it. I remember the time he had the chest waders on and walked across.
You could feel the carp hit your leg.
So. And when next to the three-bay shed, to the north of it, we have what we call affectionately a chicken coop. No, it's not used as a chicken coop. That's a building that Tom and I and
Carl Johnson
worked on. We had a heck of a time with that building, but that was mostly a storage building after the three-bay shed became being used for what it was supposed to be used for. But nowadays, that is a limited storage. It may be interpreted as something else in the future, but right now we call it chicken coop, but everybody knows what it means when they go there. And just to the north of the chicken coop is our barn. Now, the original barn on the site, when we got it from the Coosa Papers, was a more modern barn, probably turn-of-the-century barn.
Yeah, 1900.
And it was in pretty tough shape, but it had been cabled and things like that. And you can tell the story of when we took the cables off.
Well, we took the cables off, and that Wisconsin conservation crew came and started taking the siding off, and it was nasty. I mean, it wasn't even good to use for barn boards to sell for decorative purposes. And we had it there, and we were working on it one evening, and Rob took a big, long 2x4 to jar a piece loose way up
on
in
top.
Where the hayloft would be. And he must have hit the right one, and all of a sudden, that great big barn laid down right now.
Yeah.
Scared us half to death.
Yeah. Well, I also remember another time we were burning excess stuff, you know, junk, and it caught fire. And the fire department came out. I guess we should just left it burn.
Oh, yes, absolutely. After they left, I'm going, thanks, guys, but, you know, we shouldn't have called you. We should just left it burn.
Yeah, as long as it didn't affect anything else. I guess that we were a little worried about
that. Well, that's it. Yeah.
The barn we have today is a modeled after the Bob and Joy Hess barn, which was west Pittsville. We had kind of taken down an old barn that they had on their property. They invited us out to look at it. We went out with screwdrivers and tested it, thought it was pretty good. We got it to the site. It was too bad of a shape. So I guess innovation, you got to think outside the box. So I went to Solaris and asked if I could get some old telephone poles. Well, they happened to be just taking down a whole bunch of telephone poles in County Trunk Z. The only problem was they were Lion telephone poles. and they delivered them into our yard.
I think it was the other way around. We got them from Alliant and they were Solaris poles.
Was it?
I think that was, I don't, Solaris has given us a number of poles over the years, so it gets a little fuzzy on what, you know.
But anyway, it was one other company's poles. And so they delivered them all in our yard, and we thought, well, we can make them out of that. We contacted Pat Roosh, who had built the log house, so he knew how to make the saddle mount in for building it, so we could lay them in and then, you know. So we got enough telephone poles, and we decided we had the foundation up already, so we're going to build the exact same size. It's about 30 by 36 or something in that area, and then we built it out of these used telephone poles, and that turned out really good.
It is weathered really, really well. At first, you could see the creosote stains and things, but now with the weathering, it just looks old.
Yeah,
and it really has turned out nice, and it is actually an exact copy of Hess's 100-year-old barn. So I mean, we aren't stretching the truth there at all.
No, it just didn't work out that we could use their materials. We used their format and their plan, but we had to use different materials. But you know, it was a nice part of the telephone poles. It didn't cost us anything other than the labor involved, and it was quite a labor because we had to almost have a crane to lift them up and move them and stuff. Did Pat bring his?
No, Al lives over on Hollywood Road. No, I can't think of his name. He gave us a tractor to use.
Okay.
And we had it for several seasons, putting the logs up with a tractor. Yeah.
Wally Scholl.
That's who it was. It was Wally.
Wally Scholl.
That's who it was.
Yeah, Wally, there's a bunch of these people that were into the tractors, and for a number of years we've had, you know, they came with their old tractors and did different functions on our site. And Wally Scholl, Jim Allen, a number of those people came and did this sort of thing. And the next building, the blacksmith shop, which is just to the west and a little bit south of the three bay shed. That one's built from scratch. We tried to do with that one, I think, Tom, is to build a higher roof line because all of our buildings, we didn't want all the same roof line and everything. Otherwise, it looks like a cookie cutter sort of thing. And so it's got a higher roof line. And the bricks, I think the bricks came, I think I had the bricks.
Yes, you had them out there where the family center is now.
My dad, when he built his business on West Grand, took, of course, he was the mold where you save everything. So he took, there was a big double garage out of bricks there. So he took them down and he had them hauled out there and just dumped. And then we went out and salvaged a bunch of those bricks. And I think Dick Smurs and a number of people.
Carl and Dick,
kind of built that chimney and that forge and everything there. I guess if you'd asked our resident blacksmith, Ken Hartshee, the only problem is you got to get quite a fire in that chimney to get it to draw. So you got to build a preliminary fire when the blacksmith is there way back in the chimney so that the forge will draw.
Yeah. The design of it looks right, but we've got something goofed up, but we're a bunch of amateurs and obviously we didn't do it right, but they make it work.
Yes.
Those, Tracy Rice and Kenny and John Berg and the guys that have worked in there over the years, they got that down so that they make it work.
I was just talking to John Berg yesterday. I saw him at the library, and we were talking about a blacksmith. Probably the most important trade in any community, you'd be a blacksmith, because they could fix anything if it was made out of iron or repair it. And you can see back in those days how important it was. And so we felt that we needed a blacksmith shop because any community of any worth would have a blacksmith shop. So that was a project that was probably one of our shorter projects, probably overall, I think, from start to finish.
Yeah, it didn't feel like it at the time, but in retrospect, it certainly was.
And then we'll go out to Tom's cabin, the trader's cabin. Yeah. Tom, you want to tell them a little about that?
I think my family was about ready to get rid of me. It was in the early 90s. Gene and Shirley Cussman lived on the corner of Strawberry Lane and First Street North, just before you go into Bearden. And they wanted to tear the house down, leave the garage, and then build a nice retirement home for the two of them there. They had bought the house a number of years before, and it was getting a little dilapidated. Well, they start tearing it apart, and they find a log cabin in the center of the house. They didn't know it was there.
Right.
They called Mike,
I think because it was on property one time owned by Robert Wakely, yes, and I think that's the linkage was. Yeah.
Between, they called him, and we finally worked out a deal where we had 30 days to move it, or they were going to come in and just take it out to the landfill.
It was actually, folks, this time of year. Because
Easter,
Easter time, because I remember that
earlier,
and we had to get it all done, and we borrowed a couple trucks to haul it and everything.
Spranger lumber.
Sprangers let us use a couple trucks that we could haul this stuff and get it off of there. Jane and Bryce Runnels, a couple of our active members over the years, took all the nails out of it, which
straightened all the steel, the handmade steel nails.
It was a monumental job sort of thing to take it out. So we took it all apart, got it out of there within the 30 days.
Yep.
And then moved it to the site. But basically it sat under a tarp in the parking lot.
We started taking down the day before Easter one year. And it was in March. And the next day, Easter Sunday, was snowing lightly and kind of half rain, half snow. And we had figured out that there'd be about six of us could get together in the afternoon after we took care of all the Easter festivities with our church and family dinners. So we got home from family dinner with my great aunt and my kids and one of the older boy's fiance and whatever. And I went and put my bib overalls on and my sweatshirt, and I'm out the door. My wife was going to kill me.
Where are you
going on Easter when it's snowing? So we went up there, and they took a ride later in the day. Thank goodness there was about six of us up there working. It wasn't just me. Mm-hmm. And then, so she says, well, you're not the only crazy one in town. But that was...
So it sat in the parking lot for, what was it, three years?
2 years, 3 years.
2 years, 3 years. And then we started to build a foundation. We put it... I think because it's a little different than the rest of the site, because we interpret Trader's Cabin Fur Trade, which was pretty much done by the time the Wakeleys got here.
Yeah.
But, you know, down on the 10-mile creek, there was the Greenos, had a trading post earlier than this, but it's basically where the creek comes, the Wakeley Creek comes into the river. We put it down on the point, put it high up above so we didn't worry about water or anything. Started with the foundation. Just a kind of a crawl space underneath there, I think 4 foot walls, stone, and built that, and then started bringing it over piecemeal, and then kind of lined everything up. This is the roof joist, this is this.
We had them all numbered.
Yeah, we had it numbered and photographed at the time when we took it down. But it was kind of interesting because in any building you get some rot, so you lowered or do something a little different. Yeah. Tom will tell you a story about him and Lloyd Burt were out there one day working on a window on the west side of the trader's cabin.
We called up Lloyd and I said, hey, let's...
You had a little time in the afternoon.
Well, it was Saturday morning.
Oh, Saturday
morning. And I got done work and I had to be at work till 8 o'clock. So I says to Lloyd, I'll pick you up about 8:30. We'll go out there and we'll put that window frame in that window, get it done so we can, you know, keep on going. We're out there and we're working, and it's cold. I had one of the original Milwaukee, I think 12-volt battery drill things to drill with, and a couple of hand drills. Well, the battery drills didn't last very long because of the cold. And we finally got the window frame in about noonish. We walked back across the snow. I remember that it was real hard, that it rained. We get back to the car or the truck, and I turn it on, and the radio comes on and says, everything's going good. We're back up to 20 degrees below zero.
You never realized it was that cold.
No, we didn't. Both of us, we were dressed warm, we were working, and it was like, you got to be out of your mind.
What are you guys doing there, right?
Yeah, I mean, it worked out just fine. The window frame's still there, still works.
Yeah, that was quite a project because I think it was our first time working with logs.
Mm-hmm.
And like Tom had mentioned earlier, there was a log joist under the floor in the Columbia School, which when the walkers worked on it, changed them into regular 2x8s or 2x10s. Mm-hmm. And so we used those, recycled those, and put them under the cabin. So they're actually used.
Yeah, it's really good too. It's nice and solid.
Solid floor. And then put it up and we're fortunate over all these years we've worked on these buildings, and a lot of people have worked on them, that nobody's been killed.
No.
And I remember this one, that log above the top log or something on the riverside.
It's a piece of hemlock 25 feet long.
25 feet long and heavy. And we got like three ladders up there. People are helping to move it up. And somebody on the end is holding up with a pole.
We had an 8-foot 2x4.
Yeah.
And we would set it on the 2x4. And then somebody would stand under and hold the 2x4 while they repositioned the ladders to move it some more. You know, when you think about it, I could have had that 25-foot beam, whoever was holding it, it was more than just one guy. We kind of took turns.
Sure.
But we could have had that on our head. We'd have been dead for sure.
Well, for sure, yeah. So anyway, the building got up. Bob Jay built the fireplace.
Yezjeski.
Yeah, beautiful fireplace built out of all bunch of stone we've got. I remember my son Steven and I helped Bob sometimes because he'd go out there at odd hours and work on it. It was quite a job. And basically the fireplace is where it is, folks, is because when we got the log cabin, there's a big hole there. So we think, well, what are we going to fill it with? Because they had cut a doorway or something there. And so we thought, well, we got to have a fireplace. So I guess that's the place where the fireplace goes. So we filled in that hole where they had cut a door, and we put the fireplace in there. And so Bob Jay worked on that. I remember when he was up higher, up above the roof line there, he'd say he wanted a rock, and then he'd get it up to him up on the scaffolding, and then he'd say, oh, that's not the right one. Then he'd have to take it down and look for another rock to fit, you know, the perfect rock, you know, sort of thing. And the mantle in there comes from Robinson Park. They had a big windstorm years back, and the city was looking to get rid of this wood. There was white pine, there was hardwood, maple, oak, and that sort of thing. And then we kind of volunteered, said, well, we're going to get some guy with a portable sawmill. Wakely will do this. We'll hire the portable sawmill, and we split with him. I think he took the oak or something.
Most of the oak. We got a little because that's where the mantle came from.
Right.
We were cutting, and there was this chunk that's about 4x8.
Mm-hmm.
Nice solid chunk of oak, and I'm going, we got to have that for the mantle.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the first woodworking project for Wakely I ever did in my new, when I moved out
shop.
In the shop out on 32nd Street.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a beautiful mantle. In fact, Tom and I have talked about it over the years and say, well, for a trader's cabin, they would have just slopped something up there, and it's actually a little too nice, but, you know, it's great.
It's fun.
Yeah, we got a few cracks in the in between the mortar there, and we were looking for a
mason to kind of tuck point that. Yeah,
to tuck
but
point
you know
that.
When you think about it, that was engineered pretty good because that hasn't really settled much. It's kind of moved a little this way.
Yeah,
but it's not settled.
Well,
the ground.
We built a foundation underneath.
Oh yeah,
it had its own foundation underneath that, and so it was built. Bob studied it good. He was good at scoping things out and seeing how it would work. And so he scoped it all out and he built that. And to this day, it's working fine. Yeah. It's got a great draw to it.
As long as you keep the door shut.
Keep the door shut.
Yeah, you got to get the chimney hot. And then if you leave the doors open, of course, you get a swirling wind off the river and it'll get in there. But if you keep the door shut and once you get the chimney hot, that's a good fireplace.
No, Tom was... I'm not certain on this, and I'm asking you because you interpret the trader's cabin along with Joe Greco the most. Larry Knutson does some of that. But was that always meant to be a trader's cabin, or did we have some other idea? When we moved it to that point, we kind of thought it would be a trader's cabin, didn't we?
Yeah, I don't know what we thought about in the beginning, but I think that came on even before we started setting it up because it's set in its position because of the Wakely Creek and the river. When the fur trade people came into a part of the country, they didn't just build it here and say, we built it, they will come.
Right.
No, they thought this out. You get it on a major waterway with an Indian population that lives close by. Across the river, not too far away, there was an Indian village. That's been documented from research that's been done.
Mm-hmm.
And so, I mean, there wasn't a trader's cabin there, but there certainly could have been.
Mm-hmm.
And so, I mean, it was laid out that way, but, I had been doing the fur trader at the Wakely site from the third festival, so that would have been 89, 90,
mm-hmm.
And I don't know, I just kind of moved in there. I don't it's long enough to go. I don't remember if somebody said, well, now you interpret this. I just sort of figured it was to be interpreted as a fur trade.
Well, you know.
And we did.
In the early years, I used to portray Father René Menard, a French Jesuit. Yep. And you and I did a lot of things together because I was in kind of the same era you were.
Yeah, yeah.
And then when the house got to the point where it was just about done, well, you need a Robert Wakely, and I had a beard and Robert Wakely's
picture.
Actually,
you kind of look like him. I mean, in a way, you know, you're much taller, but this way, you kind of resemble him, so, you know, it
so
worked.
So that's kind of sometimes, you don't pick the character picks you.
Exactly. That's what I've always said about Pierre. I ran into him on the pages of a history book in about 89, and it just fascinated me. He was part Indian, part French. His family had been in Wisconsin for, since in the late 1700s. It just made sense. Mm-hmm. He lived near Stevens Point at one time and is now buried at Roselleville. So, I mean, it's a character that we know he knew Wakely because they signed the same petition for the mail to come up this way that made Robert Wakely the postmaster.
Yes.
They both signed that same petition. We've seen their signatures. So we know that he lived there. The timing isn't quite right for him to be the fur trader at that post, but he was there and the post is there. And he kind of, what I try to do is tell the story of the fur trade using him as the storyteller.
Right, and like we mentioned earlier, the Greenos were down on 10 Mile or Iron Creek or whatever they used to call
it. 10 Mile or 14, we're not quite sure because they called it Iron Creek.
Yeah, and so they were down there. So there was trading posts in the area. And so this was a natural kind of, if you're going to put it on the site, this is where it would go.
Well, and somebody's got to tell the story of before Wakely's. They didn't just show up there on a fluke.
Right.
There had been people, European descent people here 100 years, off and on. Mm-hmm. And so it kind of works.
So it worked out good. And the trader's cabin is, you know, we got a little grove of red pine between that and the prairie and the house. And we try to keep it look a little separate so that it isn't right directly. You don't see it the first thing you come to the site sort of thing. And I think that little separation, almost like the school is separated on the other side of the creek, a little different era, but on the same site sort of thing. Yep. The next building just north of Tom's Trader's Cabin, I refer it to Tom's, it's actually Historic
it's
Point
not,
Basses,
yes,
but, but we always refer to the building.
I just stay there sometimes.
It is our warehouse. And now we know from the survey records that were done that there was a warehouse on the site because people bringing merchandise up the river, of course, from that point onward, it had to go overland, and there was that portage to Plover Road that went right past the Wakely's house. And so that would have been a natural spot. Now, we don't know exactly where that warehouse is, but it's probably about where it would logically be.
According to the sketch, we've got to be within a few yards of where it was.
Yeah.
Now, there was no peat and mill in those days.
Yes.
So that kind of changes. I was just reading the, because I was checking on the river, there's a 41-foot head on the peat and mill dam. So that's raised a lot of water level. So it could have been
down
that the warehouse was down on the bank below. We don't know. We can't go there now because the river's there.
Yeah,
so we did as good as we could do.
And plus the river rises at different times that it comes up on that bank sort of thing, so you can see it. But this was a, it came from the Osowskis, and they were cranberry farmers. And this is west of City Point, a long ways away. The tractor guys, Wally Scholl and Jim Allen, helped transport this thing back. In fact, Mr. Osowski helped us a little bit because the snow was already, you know, I think it was like November, early December, and we were getting this building out. It was used originally by her, I think it was grandfather, it was a horse barn or something to that regard, and it had some stalls in it. And of course, we had the idea right away of using it as the warehouse. So that came and got photographed and marked and everything and put aside not very far from where it sits now. And then we built the foundation for it. Actually, it sits on piers, which we cover with rocks around the bottom. And then we put that in there. And so It's got a different roof style. One of our members, Don Matthews, came up with a little different roof style. I think we were a little short of boards or something, too, at the time.
At the Sugar Bush, just recently, I happened to be walking that way, and the guy from Eau Claire, that, remember we talked about him? The couple that came visiting from Eau Claire, he asked me, what's the deal with the roof? I've never seen one like that. I said, well, we cut white pine. The Poggles out at Rudolph gave us a bunch of red pine, logs that we were going to use for rafters. Mm-hmm. Some were longer than others. So rather than try to go over to and recut some more, we just kind of made the roof sort of an angle like that.
Yes.
We were using the materials we had, which we felt, we don't know what their warehouse looked like, but they had to use the materials they had also. Mm. And so we put it on. It works just fine. We're going to go with it.
Yeah. And this was previous to the time we got the land that Barb and Carl Johnson had bought from the parking lots out to County Trunk Z. They had purchased that for our organization. We had, I think I was president at the time, and we had a kind of a bidding thing going with the people that owned that property. And I just thought it was too doggone expensive. I went up to a certain point, I don't know if it was $20,000 or $25,000, and I said, I'm done. I can't put this organization in debt to get that property. And Carl was following along because he was active at
he
the
was
time.
Board member.
Board member. And him and his wife just decided at that point, hey, we don't want this to get away from you guys. They bought it, and so they donated it to Historic Point Boss. So it kind of doubled the size of our property.
Carl was having some health issues, and he wanted that to be his legacy. Mm-hmm. And it certainly has proved to be. I mean, at the time, I'm going, oh, Carl, what, not out loud.
You're right.
And he was one of my very, very best friends. And at the time, it's like, oh, that's a lot of money. Good Lord. He says, no. He says, I want this so that we don't have people building right up to us. We go to some of these other sites that we visit from time to time, and they're in town.
Yeah. Well, a good example is Heritage Hill.
Oh, yeah.
In Green Bay. Beautiful site.
Oh.
But you got highway and you got everything around
right
you.
Around
got the,
it.
You got the state prison across the road.
Yeah.
And
but so Carl and Barb bought that and deeded it to us. And now it's like, what would we do without this thing?
Yes, yes.
Because our new pole shed is out there. And
we've extended a
big parking lot.
We've extended two parking lots since that point. So that's the reason we were out to Rudolph getting these red pine, and we didn't want to go back because we didn't own this property. Now we could just cut a couple red pine on our own property. We got plenty of them there and use them as we have used them. So that serves a good function. If there was any problem there because of some rotted logs, we had to lower everything, and so it's a little low going in.
I have to duck, and I'm not very tall.
It's about 5 feet or 4'8" or something to get through the doorway. But once you get in there, other than one of the beams or something like that, it works fine. And we use it for kind of days when the weather isn't so good. We've had somebody throwing bowls in there, doing some pottery sort of thing. This year there might be some quilt people in there during the festival, so it's a kind of a nice space. We've used it for some school groups at sometimes, or it's a possibility to use it if you want to throw turkey darts or something
it's
or some activities.
It's raining in the afternoon. It's a program space that we could use.
One of the benefits of it, Tom and I and Johan, one day we're talking amongst ourselves, and that inside was dark, folks.
Oh.
And there's only like one window in the back and then the doorway in the front. There's nothing else there. And we thought to ourselves, what about whitewashing? Whitewashing's been around for centuries.
Oh, many centuries.
And so we got a kind of a nice mix, and we did one coat, looked really good, and we thought, one more coat and this thing will look great, and it does now.
It's
much lighter in there.
Yep. And to use it as a program space, and who knows? I mean, I don't think that they probably whitewashed Wakely's, but they certainly could have because the technology to do that is centuries old.
It's there, yeah. And our last newest building, so to speak, is the bunkhouse. The bunkhouse is between the house and the three-bay shed on the backside of the house. And that's put in like the warehouse, almost identical spot where it stood. Mm-hmm. It stood within about 3 feet of wherever it's at now. And I think it's probably a little bigger, but we wanted a more versatile space that we could use for programming if we had some program to do. Probably maybe 3-4 feet longer and maybe a couple foot narrower than what it is now. But to use it for programming space and make it big enough that we could do other things in it, we did that. Now that one started, that's also on pillars.
Mm-hmm.
We've been doing pillars because this other one is cost and time prohibitive almost.
Well, it preserves the building a little
right.
better. It never gets wet.
And and that one is built out of almost all materials that we've gotten from people. I think a bunch of maybe Fred Murray's one in there that we've mm-hmm. got one of the people have donated materials. Jim Allen's, a lot of his has gone in there. So a lot of people have donated different rough cut lumber and everything like that, and even some of our own that was done on the site.
Yeah, well, from Archie's, those pine trees that Ken gave us that we helped take down mm-hmm. in Nacusa, a lot of that stuff we had it cut right on
that's,
site.
That's all the outside.
Yes, the siding.
Siding
part,
on it. And so I think that building turned out really good, and like we say on all of our building projects, folks, it'll be done in the fall. We traditionally dedicate them in the fall, but we'll never tell you what year it's going to be done. Because sometimes with the best of intentions, we think we can do it in a year or two, and sometimes I think that from start to finish was probably a good 3 years.
Two and a half at least.
Yeah. So, yeah. But it turned out beautifully. Larry Knutson does most of the interpretation in there, though all of us have been in there at different times. It's got
bunks.
Double bunks on each side, so you could sleep, I suppose, eight, or somewhere in that area,
mm-hmm.
and it's a real good usable space, yeah. And I think it turned out fantastic.
I do too. And there's the bunk on the bottom is wider, and that was kind of the way they used to have. Sometimes had a movable bench
mm-hmm.
in front of the bunks where the guys would sit before they went to bed or.
And
in the
it's
morning
also
to get
a
dressed.
Good place if you're doing programming where people
right.
can sit and you can
yeah.
talk to them. It's got a nice little stove in there that kind of keeps it fairly warm.
Yep.
The windows, my neighbor was putting in new windows, Bob Waltz next to me, and I said, well, Bob, what are you going to do with those? Like bathroom windows, the little windows. And I said, what are you going to do with those? He says, I'm going to just throw them out there. He says, I'm so save them for me. So we saved them, and those are the three windows in there.
Yep.
They're redone, but those are the three basic windows in there, which slide, which was a great idea. I don't
yeah.
know who came up with that idea.
Don did.
Yeah. You could go up with them, but it's either all open or not open.
Yeah.
The sliding thing, you can have it open a crack or
and
not.
And from the research he did, whether they'd use them or not there, that technology was out there. That
mm-hmm.
he had seen in a couple of historic houses where they did have sliding windows.
Mm-hmm.
So it's another case of, well, this was out there and it was used in the era, so.
It's a mother invention. And
yeah.
and that bunkhouse couldn't be in a better place, folks, because that was a briar patch and thistle and everything else in there, so.
There was a big box elder tree in
yeah.
there that was literally falling down.
Right.
And finally we just.
Took it down.
Bit the bullet, there we go.
Yeah.
And took it down and cleaned that up and it really works.
It's a good use of the space. The only other building I haven't mentioned is the outhouse, which was built by Lou Berg, John Berg's wife, and Patty Kickard. I don't know what kind of help they had, but it was originally built as a ticket booth. We had it on the trail when you came in as a ticket booth, and we just decided we weren't using it for a few years, and we decided, hey, we need an outhouse, and this
and
is going to work
shape.
Good. And it's the right shape and size, so we made outhouse of it. So there, basically, you have a grand tour of our buildings, and we invite you to come down to our site and see them personally. And so, thanks,
June,
Tom.
June 8th and 9th will
ninth.
Be our next open day.
Right.
That'll be our festival.
Mm-hmm. And we'll be back to talk about that.
Oh, yeah.
Sort
oh, yeah.
of thing. So, thanks, Tom, for coming on
hey,
and reminiscing.
Fun.
And
it was fun.
Yeah. Thanks, ladies and gentlemen, for watching Historic Point Boss Update.